6. Aislen clocked into the hospital with less than a minute to spare. Since running was a no-no at the facility, Aislen did her fastest speed walk down the hall, threw her bags into her locker, and then on towards the nurse's station. She hated feeling rushed, but hated being late even more. She was frazzled and edgy, a feeling she'd been fighting all day long. Out of sync with the world, she had dropped things, bumped into people, and hit every single red light on her way to work. She arrived at the counter out of breath, just in time to help the charge nurse prep medications for the residents.
"Well, there you are," Rachel said as she got up to the med cart. "Running late isn't like you. I was starting to worry."
"I know. I'm so sorry. Today's been insane." Rachel laughed.
"Well, you've come to the right place then, haven't you?"
Aislen grimaced at the faux pas. When you worked in a mental health facility such as Chrysalis, using the words like crazy or insane was pretty much frowned upon. "I'm sorry. I'm so off today."
"Need a cup?"
Rachel gestured at the little pill cups filled with medication lined up on the cart and laughed again.
"Wow, you're incorrigible," Aislen responded, finally laughing a little.
"No different than any other day," said Rachel. "After 20 years of working here, I have a well-developed, sick sense of humor.
The cart is ready if you want to do the rounds."
"Okay, thanks." Aislen started to push the cart away.
"Oh, before I forget," said Rachel. "Troy was looking for you before his session started. He wanted to see if you wanted to go with him to an appointment at the ARC. I told him it was okay and that I'd cover for you as long as you were back by the end of my shift."
"Do you know what that's about?" Aislen asked.
"He didn't go into it, but you know how he is, always trying to mentor you with your career," said Rachel, making quote marks in the air around mentor.
"Yeah, right," said Aislen, slightly embarrassed.
"I think he has a little more interest in you rather than career counseling, lucky girl."
"Okay, stop. It's not like that," Aislen said, flushing a bit at the insinuation. Troy Kellen was a fairly new therapist at Chrysalis. He was polite and professional, nothing but respectful to all the nurses and aides. More importantly, he seemed completely authentic, without the enormous ego that nurses had come to expect from other therapists and facility doctors. That alone scored him big points on the floor. It didn't hurt that he was also cute as hell. Troy wasn't hot in the bulky, brawny, sex god way. He was tall, with the lean, sinewy physique of a swimmer. Unlike so many other guys, he didn't appear to put much effort into his appearance. No long hours at the gym, no overly styled hair or mani-pedis for him. He was casual and relaxed, wearing khaki dockers and long-sleeved shirts rolled up to the elbows and no tie. But what made all the nurses swoon was the particular way he looked at you during a conversation. The steady gaze of his soft brown eyes that peeked out from beneath his tousled golden brown locks, and the slight play of amusement on his lips. You could easily believe you were the only person in the world. He would listen attentively, respond with something insightful and interesting, then flash the kind of smile that made you just want to grab his face and plant a huge wet kiss on him. Not Aislen, of course. She couldn't get distracted by cute. All the flitting and primping that occurred when Troy walked in the door was enough to make her gag. It was especially annoying because he seemed completely unaware that his mere presence caused such a stir among the ladies. Rachel's comment was completely ridiculous. Yes, Troy had been very helpful, providing her with information and encouragement about the variety of career paths she could take after graduation. During their conversations in the break room and quiet moments when residents had settled down for the night, Troy would hang out and do that thing that got the ladies' panties damp, asking questions about her life and her goals, what had motivated her to become a nurse, what she liked about working in psychiatric care. And he listened to her answers as if he actually gave a shit. Aislen had worked for Chrysalis for 4 years. After slogging through a semester at the junior college with absolutely no idea of what she wanted to do with her life, she had landed a job here as a nurse's aide. The busy pace, wide variety of tasks, and satisfaction she got from helping her patients grew on her, and she became an LVN. When she decided to continue with school and work on becoming an RN, she thought the hard part was done. She had expected things to get easier once she made a decision about what to do with her life. But there were so many different avenues, specialties, and advanced degrees available. She found herself even more overwhelmed now that she was nearing the end of her program. Troy had been encouraging Aislen to pursue an advanced degree in psychology. It would have been much easier for Aislen to just be satisfied with her achievement and settle into a secure career. But Troy touched on something within her. As much as she loved her work, she did feel there was something more she was supposed to be doing with her life. "Aislen, you're intelligent, capable, and insightful," Troy had said. "I would hate to see you settle because you think this is the best you could do. Not that being a nurse isn't a great profession. I just think you have so much more to offer." Aislen warmed under the compliment, flattered that he thought so highly of her. Although she'd never admit it, his praise made her a little breathless, especially with that look. But Aislen quickly reminded herself that Troy seemed to engage like that with everybody, from aide to nurse to janitor to the most delusional patient. It was just his manner. People shouldn't take that personally. Aislen tried not to. And besides, fraternization between coworkers, while not a violation of policy, was just not professional. And Troy was mindful of that. Clear boundaries were important to him. Any kind of flirtation would have been out of character for him. He couldn't help it if he was so freaking hot. Aislen had a lot of respect for Troy. While most of the therapists did the minimum, led their sessions, completed their rounds, recommended blood work, or asked doctors to reevaluate medication, Troy was young and still enthusiastic about his work. He had no delusions about curing all the people that were hospitalized for their disorders and addictions, but he was optimistic and felt that a compassionate ear helped ease his patients' burdens. He didn't just facilitate sessions and run out the door. He hung around, actually talked to the patients, and listened to them. He told Aislen that there was healing in the idea that you had really been heard. Aislen was rotated through the various wings of the hospital every few months. Her current assignment was in the geriatric ward, caring for the elderly patients suffering from dementia, Alzheimer's, schizophrenia, and other disorders. Many of Aislen's patients had lived through a time when their illnesses were treated without their consent, and electroshock treatments or lobotomies left them incapacitated. It wasn't your everyday nursing home. The patients here required more maintenance and structure than other facilities. Aislen pushed the med cart door to door. It was like reverse trick-or-treating. The residents in her wing knew the drill. Their internal clocks clambered for med time as though it were lunch. They were already standing at their doors waiting for their little white cups of calm. She double-checked Rachel's doses, dispensed them to the correct patients, and documented it in their charts. "Morning, Sigmund," Aislen said to the elderly male sitting in his wheelchair outside room number 11. "Good morning, Astrid," Sigmund replied, reaching up with his ancient, spindly fingers. He called every female in the facility Astrid. Whether Astrid was a long-lost love, a departed sister, or a daughter, no one knew. Sigmund Lang had been a resident at Chrysalis for many years, and he never had any visitors named Astrid, or anyone else, for that matter. "No, Sigmund, it's Aislen," she said. It was important to remind patients of reality rather than support their delusions, although it wouldn't do any good with Mr. Lang. Physically, he was actually holding up pretty well for an 86-year-old man, but his dementia was severe. Besides thinking everyone was some woman from his past, he rambled in a language of numbers. He would sit in his chair, stare out his bedroom window, reciting strings of integers only an MIT grad could decipher, and tap his fingers together as if counting to infinity. He looked like a nutty professor, the palest of gray-blonde hair, wispy, long, and astray in every direction. His once clear blue eyes clouded over like an overcast sky. He never seemed to focus on anything but the equations and formulas in his mind. Although Aislen was pretty good at math, this language was beyond her ability to translate. Aislen handed Mr. Lang his med cup. He took it in his shaky hand and stared deeply into it for a few moments. Aislen watched him, wondering what he was looking for. Reading the tea leaves of his destiny, maybe? She was also curious as to what kind of assignment Troy had planned for her today. He was always requesting her assistance in different group sessions, exposing her to as many different levels of psychiatric care that he could. This appointment was new. Aislen had never been to the ARC. You couldn't go there without a special clearance, but you could accompany someone who had one. She was actually looking forward to seeing what the facility was about. And although the prospect sent a flutter of nervousness through her stomach, the opportunity of being alone with Troy, outside of the facility walls, wasn't an unappealing prospect. Aislen looked down the main corridor toward the nurse's station. Troy was leaning back against the counter talking to Rachel. Aislen couldn't help but marvel at the easy rapport he had with people. Rachel took a hard, intimidating stance in the presence of most doctors, but she treated Troy as she treated her nursing staff, with good-natured warmth. Troy laughed at something Rachel said, and Aislen felt a pang of jealousy, which was ludicrous. Rachel was an awesome lady, but she was at least 20 years older than Troy, and married. And what did Aislen care anyway? She was losing it. It had been a slow spiral down into the crazies for her today. Maybe the stress of her upcoming finals really was getting to her. She didn't need to feel overwhelmed, but maybe she was more anxious about school than she realized. Maybe the all work, no play was taking a toll on her psyche. Maybe she could run some of this by Troy. He should have some insight about stress. Aislen looked down at Mr. Lang and found him staring back up at her. The clouds in his eyes had departed, and they were clear and bright blue. "You aren't Astrid," he said. Aislen was shocked. Never in her 4 years that she'd worked here had he had a moment of clarity.
No, Mr. Lang, I'm not. My name is Aislen.
"Aislen," he said, rolling it across his tongue as though he were correcting her. Her blood turned cold and a knot seized up in her stomach. The only person that had ever pronounced it that way was her father all those years ago.
"It means a dream, you know," he continued.
No, she didn't know. She didn't know it even had a meaning. She could only stare at the old man, speechless. Mr. Lang leaned over in his chair as if he were going to tell her a secret, and whispered to her,
"Are you awake yet?"
Aislen dropped the med chart, sending it clattering down the hall. Her head was in a full spin now. A claw of ice shivered down her scalp, then raked her whole body like fingernails on a chalkboard. Her knees buckled. A secure warm arm slid around her waist and kept her from melting into the floor.
"Aislen, are you okay?"
It was Troy. Rachel was standing right behind him.
"What happened, hun?" she asked. "Do you feel all right? You look like you've seen a ghost."
Aislen caught her breath and shook her head, trying to clear it. She became very aware of the heat radiating off of Troy. He was holding her close against him. She could feel the taut ripples of muscle beneath his shirt, and she thought she would faint for real this time for a completely different reason. She pushed herself off of him, regaining her composure.
"No, I'm fine. I just slipped on something."
Rachel looked down at Sigmund. Mr. Lang, are you drooling again? Trying to trip up my nurses? Aislen looked back down at Sigmund. His eyes had veiled into milky clouds, and he was once again lost in his numbers.